Rahul Sarugaser joins me now. He is the analyst with Paradigm Capital. I had to give my head a shake there. We've had so many analysts in a few days. Rahul, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you very much for having me.
Rahul, the thing that generated my first interest in reaching out to you was I received an invitation to a biosynthetics conference as it pertains to cannabis, and I thought, wow, this is what I call first mover. That's the first time I've seen that. So what? How did you become the first sort of institutional name that was actually promoting a group of biosynthetic producers?
Yeah, that's a great question. So basically, myself and my associate Michael Freeman, we're both engineers, and we're both biopharma guys,
right.
And we've been focusing on the development of clinical assets, both in cancer, but also in the cannabis space. And we wanted to understand what are the technologies that are going to be the future of this industry. And because we're biopharma guys, pharma makes their drugs in E. coli and in yeast, and this is a clean, crisp way of making drugs. And so we wrote a white paper back in January. We've really been talking about this for the last year, but wrote a white paper in January talking about how biosynthesis, the use of yeast or E. coli or some other microorganism, can be used to make CBD or THC, or what we call APIs, active pharmaceutical ingredients. And by using this modality to manufacture APIs, we can bring down the cost of goods significantly, probably 10 to 100 times what can be produced in the plant. It can be consistent, and it's very, very scalable. And so, for example, a room this size could probably replace thousands of square feet of grow space of plants.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so there's so many interesting aspects to the biosynthetic sourcing of cannabinoids. At this time, there is nobody producing cannabinoids on a commercial scale, correct?
That's correct.
And yet there are several companies that are through the laboratory phase and sort of starting to experiment with commercial phases.
Right.
And for me, now you can correct me if I'm wrong, I'm watching seven companies right now. Some are trying with genetically modified yeast, some are trying with genetically modified bacteria, and some are trying with genetically modified algae.
Right.
And my first question with that setup is, are there additional mediums being experimented with that you know of?
Those are the primary three media
that
are being used, and there are some non-traditional microorganisms that are being investigated by companies like Celebre.
Mm-hmm.
So Ginkgo, for example, that did the deal with Cronos, they're looking at using yeast, or effectively baker's yeast.
Right.
And then you have companies like InMed in Vancouver who are using E. coli.
Mm-hmm.
And then Amaris, who just did the $300 million deal with Lavvan, are likely to be using baker's yeast as well. So we see the majority of the companies using yeast,
mm-hmm.
A few of them using E. coli, and a small number using algae. And as we look at these companies, we really are finding there are three primary criteria that we're looking at to evaluate the strength of these companies, and that is one of three, which is what is the microorganism, or the industry term is chassis, that is being used. But just as importantly is, what is the strength of the team that is looking to develop this particular chassis for the manufacturing of cannabinoids, whether it's THC, CBD, or some other cannabinoid. And biosynthesis has really been around for more than 40 years. We've been making insulin for 30 years using biosynthesis. We've been using biosynthesis to make most of our cancer drugs, which are antibodies. And so this technology is not new. It's just application of it into a new space. And as a result, there are teams out there, for example, that have come from synthetic genomics or Intrexon or other places like that, and even Amaris, that have expertise in being able to do this. And so we're looking for the companies that have teams that have kind of spun out of these first-in-class companies.
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, finally, and just as importantly, is the intellectual property. And again, because yeast and E. coli have been used as chassis for such a long time, they're fantastically malleable, and there are great tools in order to engineer them. But as a result, there's also quite a lot of IP that's been filed in the space over many, many years. And so the companies that we see positioning themselves best are also looking to file IP and or secure IP that will give them the freedom to operate in the space. So really those three criteria are kind of symbiotic, and they all have to work together.
Sure. So you use the term chassis. How do you spell that?
Oh boy. C-H-A-S-S-I-S.
Okay. So it's like as if chassis on the car that carries everything else kind of thing?
Exactly. It's like a vehicle.
Okay. That makes sense. Interesting terminology. So out of the three main media or chassis types, you've got your bacteria, your algae, and your yeast that we've both been hearing about. Do any of those strike you at this time in the evolutionary career as way out in front of the others in terms of functionality or limitations?
That's a fantastic question. It's a question that we've been wrestling with. In our white paper, we had sort of taken the position around a yeast or some form of yeast. But as we've dug into the space and met most, if not all, of the companies that are doing this, we're learning that it's really symbiotic between the chassis, the team, and the IP. Because if you're developing a mechanism of manufacturing in E. coli, you have to have the IP to be able to do it there. Or if you're doing it in yeast, you have to have the IP to do it there. So I wouldn't say that one is necessarily the best, or we are not yet, that technology is not evolved yet, that we've been able to identify which one is the best by far. Mm-hmm. But it's important to recognize that this is not a zero-sum game. It's not going to be just one biosynthesis company that's going to win. There's probably going to be five, maybe even 10. And that's why we see the space similar to the large cannabis companies. Investors don't have to be scared and say, oh, which one, did I pick the wrong one? It's about trying to pick, you know, one of those top five or one of those top 10. Mm. And herein lies the opportunity, and which is why we're hosting this conference on April 15th to present to investors and to present to the large growers who are looking to, you know, take a hedge in this space. Aggregating the best companies that we've seen. And this is really the first time, to our knowledge, that there's been a critical mass of biosynthesis companies that have come together. And even some of the CEOs of these companies have been quite impressed with the other companies that have agreed to participate. So we're quite excited about it.
Sure. So then has any one company emerged as being far out ahead of the pack at this point?
Oh, that's a tough one. So I'll mention sort of what we think are some of the best five, and recognizing that this is a dynamic list and things are changing. So, you know, near the top of that list, of course, is Ginkgo that did the deal with Cronos, and Cronos made a very savvy bet there. Celebre, which is a startup company out of San Diego that is using a non-traditional chassis and have a team out of synthetic genomics, which is essentially the brain trust of synthetic biology. There is, of course, Intrexon, that have years and years of expertise doing this. Amaris, of course, who did a $300 million deal with Lavon in the space. And then the last one is actually still in stealth mode. So, but they will be, they're having their IP published literally in the next couple weeks, and they'll be presenting at our conference as well. So
Is that the algae one?
No, okay.
I'm trying to squeeze out any little tidbit that I could get that might give me a hint as to who it is. Well, okay, so your conference on April 15th, I'm excited about that. I hate conferences. I almost never go to them. But this is intriguing because it's kind of like right out there at the cutting edge in an area that a lot of people aren't even aware of yet.
And that's a key reason that we're having this conference, is that, you know, we've been talking about this space for a year. Ginkgo and Cronos did the deal almost a year ago, or 6 months ago. And most investors in the cannabis space tend to be intimidated by, when they hear biosynthesis, they see a chemical cascade. You know, they're more comfortable with grow space or square footage or grams per square foot. But the fact is, with the advent of differentiated products coming online in October, the APIs that are going to be included in these differentiated products are, you know, sourcing of them is going to be very, very important. And so this freight train is coming. And if, you know, we can, you know, investors can hide as long as they want, but if they don't want to get left behind, it's really important that they learn about where this next generation of APIs are going to be produced. And for example, when Walmart and General Mills and Pepsi and Coke get into the space, you know, it's going to be difficult for them to source APIs from plants where it can be relatively inconsistent, where pricing is going to be a significant issue, and they're going to want high quality, low cost, consistent and very scalable production.
You bet. Okay, so where is the conference? Who qualifies and how do you get to go?
So it's invitation only at the moment, so you have an invitation. We are planning it at our offices on York Street. However, we've had such an overwhelming response that we're now looking for a larger space.
Oh, wow.
So stay tuned on the exact location. It's going to be an afternoon event on April 15th. And then, of course, we'll have a networking session. And it's something that's very important for all of these companies because we only had 10 slots, and there's at least probably 20 companies coming. And so we're providing for a lot of networking opportunities during the conference for both investors and the companies to get to know each other.
Wow, very exciting, Rahul. I'm so glad to have had you today. And we're going to look forward to the conference, and we'll have you back afterwards to get an update on what you saw that you liked.
Thanks,
James. Thank you for joining me today.
Cheers.